Our next topic, let's see, this is our last topic. Is the gospel nonsense? This is an accusation I would like to make, and then see mm-hmm. what your response is. Mm-hmm. So in my booklet, I wrote about this too. So basically, if you look at the gospel story, this is a way to phrase it. You would say this sounds silly, or it's mocking it, or whatever. But it's like factually true that you can say that God died on the cross to appease his own wrath. Because the Bible talks about actually Jesus' death on the cross was to appease God's wrath, and Jesus and God are supposed to be the same and all that. Mm-hmm. But so anyway, I think it's nonsense.
Mm-hmm. Okay.
And even the whole reason why somebody has to die for your sin is ancient, and it seems like it's based in superstitious thinking about mm-hmm. killing an animal for your sin. Killing something pure for your sin.
Okay, so you've raised the issue that theologians call atonement.
Mm-hmm.
And Christians believe, among many other things, that Jesus' death atones for us.
Yeah, so the very idea of atonement, I think, is a superstitious.
Okay, but you have latched onto a certain theory of atonement that comes from the 12th century said that's the one.
I would say every idea of atonement is kind of ridiculous.
The various theories of atonement that you think are ridiculous?
All of them. So you give me one that sounds reasonable.
Let's go historically.
Let's talk about that.
Now, what I would say is that each one of these theories has evidence for it in the New Testament. So that the real place, the Christians ought to just be, ought to admit that there are different possible theories of atonement. And
do any of them make sense, though?
Do any of them make sense?
Yeah.
Well, I think more
I
than
think
one
the reason
do.
Why there's so many theories is partly because none of them make sense, and so they have to have another version of it.
Okay. The earliest, which came many centuries before the one that you've latched onto, is the simple ransom theory. That we're the prisoners of the devil and God frees us from him. Augustine loved it. The early church loved it.
Isn't that kind of funny? It's like, how did the devil get all this power to take such
this is
ransom?
Why, and this is why Anselm rebelled against the ransom theory. Anselm comes along in the 11th century and says, we've got to have a better theory because it's given too much respect, power to the devil, right?
So you don't like that theory?
That's what Anselm said. Actually, I think there's some truth in that theory. You ask anybody who's a victim of addiction whether he needs to be ransomed or not. Ask anybody who has felt the power of God to free me from addiction. Isn't that a kind of ransoming and freeing from the power of evil? I think there's a great deal of power in the ransom theory.
The ransom theory is you make a payment to somebody who's holding you hostage.
No, the main
basically.
Idea is that you get freedom from what's holding you hostage. That's right.
Right. And supposedly, so Satan is the hostage taker here, and he needs a payment, and God says, okay, I'm going to make a payment, and that payment's going to be my blood.
Is the Satan part crucial to people who experience freedom from
it's
addictions?
It seems like it's nonsense on so many levels because Satan is a guy who's got us captive. Number one, he doesn't have any power. Number two, God's got to like make Satan a payment. That means like
okay. Now you're back to criticizing Anselm.
Is his payment? It's his own self, his own blood.
Mm-hmm. Anselm's own theory is the theory of.
I mean, if you invented a computer and your computer went awry, you thought, okay, well, this computer's got another computer. Ransom. I'm gonna have to go kill myself in order to free this thing.
You suggested that they were all bad, and I've only mentioned one.
I know.
And a half.
But look, I mean, God is all powerful and everything.
Yeah. Can we get to the others?
Okay.
Okay. Anselm's theory is the satisfaction theory. This is one that you've been ragging on all the time, so we don't have to say anything about it. That God satisfies His own honor, but it's key that God can't satisfy His own honor. Man has to satisfy God's offended honor. And so Anselm in Latin, cur deus homo, why a God-man? And so he gives us this satisfaction theory to explain. You don't like it. I think it has some weaknesses too.
I mean, even the God-man thing.
Okay. Then you come to the Protestants. Protestants finally come on the scene in the 16th century, and you get a penal substitution theory. And you'll find a lot of Protestants who are so into their penal substitution theory. That's what atonement really means. So that we have offended against God's law, and God as the righteous judge is going to punish us. That all makes sense. A while ago, you were thinking that we should punish certain people. But God also loves us. So can God let us off from what we have done? No, he just can't. It's got to be a sense of justice here. There's got to be justice. And so the penal substitution people, they say that Jesus, who really is one of us, pays the price for us. And so by faith in him, we can be saved. I suppose you don't like this one either.
God is all powerful. He made us. And he's got to pay the price by sacrificing his own blood to appease himself.
Okay, so you don't like that one either. In the 20th century, we have the Jesus as our example, that Jesus, by overcome sin and sets, borrows a little from the sets us free, by taking our place and dying and showing us how to live the perfectly moral life.
But that's not fair, though, because he's supposed to be God and man. He's got these abilities we don't have.
I don't understand.
Like Jesus healed people. He actually, in the Bible story, he brings back a guy from death. So if he has all these special powers, maybe he didn't even feel the pain he had. How do you know he wasn't just faking it?
Well, I think there's good evidence. If
he could raise Lazarus from the dead, he could probably turn off his circuit so his brain doesn't feel any pain.
The Apostle Paul in Romans suggests what I think is yet another attempt at or a way of thinking about the atonement. And I call it peacemaking atonement. Now, you suspect me of being a Quaker and dragging this in because I'm a pacifist. Well, it's probably true. But I think it's also taught in Scripture. We are God's enemies. We are God's enemies in that we want to run our lives rather than letting him run our lives. So how does God deal with our enmity toward him? He comes to tell us, in spite of your enmity, I love you. We give him the finger repeatedly. And then he carries all the way through. All right, you can even kill me. We give him the finger. We're going to run our lives. We're going to run our world. And when we kill him, and it's very important to recognize that we killed Christ, not Pilate or somebody. Don't blame somebody else. One of the great sins of Christian history is blaming the Jews. When we killed Christ, we discovered that we lost. He defeated us. He overcomes us and makes peace with us, Paul says, by the cross. He redeems us to himself. Now,
and this was all God's plan before he created anything, before the foundation of the world.
Yeah, God was willing. Diogenes Allen, a philosopher who now is dead, makes the point that in loving us, the supreme act of love that we experience is when we recognize, and usually for brief instances, the true reality of another person. Most of the time, we think of other people as in orbit around us. Iris Murdoch says this is because she takes a Freudian view of human psychology. We are just driven by these unconscious desires, and it's just natural for us. Other people are just things in our lives, but every once in a while, we get this little sliver of recognition that other people are genuinely independent, they're genuinely real. Even in what we call the most intimate love relationships, it's not that often that we really see the other as they really are. And we love them. God sees us as we are, and he wills that we be separate, be truly independent, to be whole beings. Alan puts it, he is a center of being, and he wills that we be centers of being. And because of that, he relinquishes control. He lets us be what we want. He lets us kill him.
I mean, just the idea of killing God seems like it's a lot of nonsense there, too.
Okay.
Do you see the problem I'm having?
You're having a problem with the whole idea of the incarnation. And I have 25 seconds left. Yeah. I'm not going to try to defend the incarnation. But I do think it represents something deeply profound about God's nature, that he reaches out to us and will not stop reaching out to us even when we kill him.
I think it's interesting. I mean, when I was a Christian, I could have a It's easier for me to believe it when I was also naive about other religions, but when you learn about other religions like Hinduism and all the other religions and all the other godmen and all this stuff, it's, I don't know, it's a different perspective.
Okay.
Okay, so out of time. Well, that's it. We got just a few minutes left in the show. Let's summarize a little bit. What did you learn today? What did I learn today?
Well, the first thing that we should learn, and this is something...
make it personal. What about me and you? What
I would hope that we learn and that other people learn that philosophy is fun. This is fun. And it's also important.
Philosophy is love of learning.
Love of wisdom,
literally.
Supposedly.
Yeah.
Yeah, supposedly. Unfortunately, in our academic world, often philosophy just becomes another way to make a buck and to get by.
And some of them are... I guess some of the philosophers were purposely vague too, or purposely hard to understand, but some of them were pretty awesome.
It seems to, I'm a very old-fashioned romantic philosopher. I think we ought to pursue truth. We ought to try to say it as clearly as we can. And we're all limited. We don't know enough. And so it is a great thing when we run into people who disagree with us. You know, Socrates and Laches. Socrates never was more than a basic grunt soldier, we would say. Laches was a general. But Socrates had the reputation for having, he was really brave, and he was showed great self-control. So they having a discussion, what is courage? Okay, Laches is a general, Socrates is a veteran, they should know what courage is. Well, what is courage, Laches? Well, it's what these young men are doing. Socrates, they're practicing with arms. Oh, really? But... you know, can women be brave? Oh yeah, but they don't ever practice with arms. Oh yeah, it's a problem, isn't it? So, you know, it's a typical basic Socratic dialogue. They try out one definition, they criticize it. They try out another definition, they criticize it. At the end of this delightful little dialogue, Laches says, well, geez, Socrates, I thought I knew what courage was, but she seems to run away from me. Socrates says, me too, isn't it? Tell you what, come back tomorrow and we'll do it again. Let's keep trying.
Yeah, you know, to me, courage sounds kind of boring, but we're almost out of time here. But okay. I mean, something I'd throw out there to for fuel for the fire.
Yeah,
I believe that philosophy should replace religion, and we don't have time to say that. But the reason why I say that is because I think philosophy is all about trying to understand the world with reason and logic. And one of the big problems with the religion is it has to do with divine inspiration and what they feel God has told them. But we're out of our show today, out of time for our show. Thanks, Phil, for
Thank
being
you very much.
On the show.
And okay. Okay. Goodbye.
Yeah. Thanks for tuning in.